People used to point at him and laugh because he dressed different, in loud clothes, and his hair, you know, was longer. And I used to dress the same way because that's the way we dressed in New York.
I saw these three guys and Elvis back in the corner. Two of them were holding him. One guy had the scissors. Yeah, we're going. Elvis was different. He wore the long hair, and yeah, all of us had crew cuts.
Yeah.
And I walked in, looked around, what's going on, boys? We're going to cut a little hair off this boy here, you know. I said, he don't look like he wants it cut off to me. He said, no, he don't, but we do. And I said, well, if you cut his, you got to cut mine, and I ain't got too damn much up here to cut. And they looked at me to see if I was serious, and they saw that I was serious, and they let him go. Now, the story, these were football players. They weren't football players. These were just redneck dumbasses.
And she just was so protective of him. But she was really, most of the time, a real up-type woman, you know. I mean, things didn't get her down that much.
She was a loud talker, and Vernon was real quiet.
Well, he was until he got to a point, and then he was a hitter, you know. And that
he abused her real bad a couple of times.
Yeah, a couple of times, yeah.
That's a big thing. You know, people who have talked about Elvis since he died, a big thing about him calling home because she wanted to check on him. But, you know, as Billy has told us in the past,
because he wanted to check.
That a big part of it was him checking to be sure that she was okay, that Vernon didn't hit her.
See, I think that's where Elvis got his, I think he got his warmth from her. Yeah. I also think he got his temper from her.
The worst fights that, and Red knows about this, and Gladys and Elvis getting a fight, it was.
Yeah.
And it always happened over the dinner table.
That's exactly right.
Scared me half the day. Lamar. Just frozen, man. I was just scared to death because I didn't know what was going to happen. Boy, it just, I mean, they were in each other's face.
Really, when he got mad, it was like a dark cloud enveloped everything, and everyone around was affected by it. He may not be angry at you. He may be angry at him, but his anger was so forceful that it just, you couldn't wait for him to get out of it because it was bad.
He could push the buttons harder than anybody alive. I mean, he knew how to push the buttons, and when he pushed them, I mean, I've seen us, I've read myself, Sonny, Marty, I've seen us all double up. I mean, he's doubled us up.
Okay, let's get back to an interesting thing here. Priscilla's come to the States, you know? And then Elvis is making these movies with all these gorgeous leading ladies, which leads us to Ann Margaret, who, and everybody here will agree, was one of the sweetest, nicest, sexiest women that we've ever met. I mean,
a whole lot of fun.
It was a real toss-up at that time between Ann Margaret and Priscilla. And Priscilla knew it too, see? And so she even goes so far as to lighten her hair and get the same look that Ann Margaret did during that time. I mean, that's how intimidated she was by that situation, and
she had every right to be.
She did, yeah.
I remember one night we were in the kitchen at Graceland one night, and the intercom buzzes. I pick up the intercom, and it's Elvis. He and Priscilla were upstairs. Get this bitch an airplane. I'm shipping her ass home. I said, okay. And I hung the phone. I told the guys Lamar was standing there. Lamar says, oh, here she goes.
Yeah.
Wing south, yeah.
And then about 15 minutes later, the intercom rings again, and he says, forget the plane ticket. I said, okay. See, the whole thing was about Ann Margaret.
You can't imagine the pressure and everything involved in being in Las Vegas for four solid weeks working, another week to rehearse, two more weeks after it was kind of playtime, but two shows a night, 7 days a week, nobody does that.
No, not anymore.
And that might kind of explain some things to people, the pressure that somebody like that is under, and we're under, not only with our families, but constant pressure from him, from the Colonel, from everywhere.
Sure.
And from the audience, and from everything that's going on. You cannot imagine.
You know, the early parts of Vegas he liked in 69, 70, 71. After that, about 73, 4, and 5, man, he hated Vegas. He could not stand.
He got handy with a gun there in Vegas. There was some funny incidents. The breakfast table, of course, breakfast was like 5 or 6 in the afternoon. It was kind of up three steps off to the dining room. And we all, you know, all the guys come in there, you know, talking loud. He was at the end of the table, and he wanted our attention. He said, hey, and everybody just kept talking like Lamar usually does, you know, yak, 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 back and forth. He said, hey, he's just nobody, everybody ignored him. Everybody ignored him. And he took the gun and said, boom, boom, boom. And you can hear the bullets ricocheting around up there. Everybody hit the floor. Lamar grabbed his heart.
Last table, it was that thick. We dived on it. I ran into you. We hit like looking up.
But you hear those bullets ricocheting.
It would rain, though. It would rain up there, and the rain.
Oh yeah, after that, it was like a, you know, you could put your flowers on there and keep them alive.
The hotel said, we don't understand what's going on. They said, why is it? They said, we just didn't put the stuff up there right. So they had to go retar it. You know, they never could understand why.
And it was leaving. It was getting close to showtime. The phone rang. I didn't see anything going on, and. It was the colonel said, well, you're going to be able to make it? And I said, Colonel, I don't think so. And boy, that was, you're talking about pressure. Because you're talking about a showroom full of people. You got to go down, somebody got to go tell them that no show tonight.
A lot of people asked questions about whether the colonel, and the statement that he made, whether he knew whether Elvis was having problems or not, and taking stuff
certainly.
And what have you.
Oh,
and
certainly.
He denies, yeah, but he says he didn't. And that answers a whole lot of questions to a lot of people that he knew by calling up there asking.
Colonel knows also, he and I talked about it, because I was on the road in advance setting up security at the hotel and everything. So I went ahead of each show with Colonel Parker, and he told me, he said, Sonny, he's getting worse, it seems. I said, he is, Colonel. He's getting worse about it. So Colonel was well aware that Elvis had a problem.
And he was like the big brother that had been out there and seen part of the world and everything, and I was learning from him, and he was taking care of us. At the end, it had reversed, where he was like a little boy that had gone off and gotten some trouble, and now we were trying to help him out, pull him through it. Just almost a reversal of the role.
I mean, I can't explain to you how many pills I lifted that would simply be there, and I'd say, well, you know, while I'm at it, I'm gonna shove a few over here and take it and simply flush it. But if he didn't get that feeling, he knew something was wrong. So you had to work real carefully. And he was crying. He said, he said, Elvis is gone this time. I said, no, man. I said, it can't be. I said, where's Dr. Nick? He said, he's in the other room with him. I said, well, then there's still hope here. And by that time, the door opened, and Dr. Nick, he walked out, and he's got these tears running down his eyes. And he reached and grabbed me, and he said, he's gone. He said, do you want to see him? And I said, I don't think so. His ways have affected us. Always will.
We
pattern a lot of our ways after him, you know.
We just everything, I guess outside of my father, he was the closest thing I had. And when we lost him, we sort of all lost part of ourselves. We never, ever recovered. We all do something every day like he did. We all do things like he did, and we can't help it. It's just part of our lives. And it's not easy. We still miss him a lot.
I will see him again.
Yeah.
I will see him.
I'm sure we'll have to get an appointment.
If there's any way Elvis ever had a doubt that we cared for him, I think this right here, if he's able, out there somewhere, to visualize it or see it, the doubt's gone.
Oh, yeah.
It's got to be gone.
And it started out with a little group. Others came along. They've all gone, but the original group is sitting right here.
Mm-hmm.
We were part of something unique. We didn't even realize what we were part of until after it was gone. And we spent a lifetime with a legend from the time we were kids,
mm-hmm.
until we were grown men, and it was a hell of an experience.